Welcome to POCUS Geek. I'm Jared Marks, and I like to talk about critical patients and critical diagnoses. And in today's video, we're going to talk about a critical patient and the diagnosis that was made. But it ended up actually being a misdiagnosis. I think it's something that we can all learn from, and so I'm putting this video out there so that you can hopefully not run into the same problems and maybe have the possibility to learn and move forward with these type of patients and how to best provide care for these patients. I'm not sure that there's entirely a right answer, and so I'm curious too to get your thoughts at the end of the video. So this patient was a critical patient brought in by transport, had passed out while with friends walking down the street, and arrived into the ER receiving CPR. CPR was continued. The patient had no pulses, and by ACLS guidelines, because they were in PEA or pulseless electrical activity, had compressions going on. During one of the pulse checks, an ultrasound was performed to evaluate to see what the heart was doing. It's a little unclear if the diagnosis was made off of this clip or if they saw subsequent images, but in the documentation, they had documented that there was no cardiac activity. And so I wanted to work you through on this video what may have been possible to do. I'm not sure that it would change mortality, but I do think it's important when we do ultrasound to understand what we're seeing and work from there. So I'm gonna show you work you through this video clip during this code. Now I do have a couple others similar to this that I will put video links up in the right-hand corner that you can look at. One in a trauma patient that had a favorable outcome and survived, and one in a medical code that had a 0% survivability rate. So in this patient, we do see that there is some cardiac motion going on. Well, there's motion going on throughout there, but some of that is due to the bagging of the intubated patient. But below this arrow, we can see the heart, and it is actually functioning quite well as far as the left ventricle, and we'll talk about the other implications that we see here. So I'm going to just color code that with red. And then above that, so next to the liver, this is a subxiphoid view. This is a standard view we get in CPR when it's going on, so that compressions can continue as soon as possible. We do see typically the liver up next to it. You may get some stomach in the way, but right now we do see this area that's just anterior to the heart. And this is echogenic, meaning it has echoes in it, and it actually looks isoechoic to the liver. So it's got similar echoes to the liver. One thing to note though is right here you do have an anechoic spot. And then just looking at the contour of it here, which is actually going to be outlined, we can see that contour is just a little bit different. We can see it comes down near the apex, it's over here, so a little bit different than the liver. In addition, we can see this area just anterior to that structure, and there's quite a bit of space there, and there's actually a structure inside of it that we can highlight here. So what do we have? So working from the top or the bottom of the screen where we can identify the heart and see that motion, we do have the heart, and then above that is actually clotted hemopericardium, and that can be quite difficult to distinguish from what we expect liver to look like, because it is isoechoic or similar echoes to the liver. And then up at the top, we do have the left lobe of the liver that we're seeing as an acoustic window. Now, why can this be confusing? Well, this can be hard in an intense, you know, critical situation to make the right diagnoses and see these. You're often in a very bright room using ultrasound, which can be difficult, and a lot of things are going on around you. But I do want to walk through what the heart looks like. And so if we look here, we can actually see the left ventricles occupying this space, the right ventricles occupying this space. We have the right atria in here, and then we're seeing the aortic root. So we're a little off plane, which is okay. That's what happens in these situations. And we're doing this in a very, you know, in a 10-second pulse check. And so it can be a little bit difficult to ascertain what's going on. But what I want you to pay attention to is how compressed the right ventricle is in this area from this clotted hemopericardium, and also the variability in the right atrial filling. And you'll see some systolic collapse, and the wall, as it comes out this way, will not be functioning properly. So we're going to go back to the video, and we can see right here again is LV. And LV function actually, in this limited view, looks pretty darn good to me. If we look at the inner walls, it's actually trying to collapse pretty well. It's pretty fast. And we see the RV right in here, and it's very compressed, very, very small. Not even a third of the LV size, just really, really tiny. And we're off plane a little bit, but mostly that's gonna be compression from this. And then we see the left atrial wall right here collapsing, and it's got that wavy motion to it, which is what we see in sonographic tamponade. So this patient right here has tamponade from a clotted hemopericardium. So my question for you guys is, what do you think the causes are? The things that come to the forefront of my mind, and please add to the list, is a dissection with retrograde extension into the pericardial sac with bleeding into it. That comes to the forefront of my mind. Another that I think could happen is you could have a possibly a ventricular aneurysm or a ventricular rupture that's led to this. I think also having a possible metastases with hemorrhagic conversion are kind of the things that come to the forefront of my mind. I don't know that running a code you're going to be able to determine this, but what I do wonder is what interventions would you guys do? I personally think trying to do a pericardiocentesis on this is just not going to be successful. I don't think that there's anything you're going to remove with that. We see it's all clotted except for maybe this area here, and that's really close to the heart. So I think that the thing that I would do at my institution, where I have a lot of consultants, is I would get a hold of cardiothoracic surgery and see what they would need to do to move forward with a possible open thoracotomy. I think it would be pretty heroic anywhere for you to do an open thoracotomy in your department, and I would suggest against that. I don't know that that's been described well for these kind of circumstances, even if it is the above or the things that I mentioned previously. I think that unless you have somebody that can, a consultant or especially a cardiothoracic surgeon that can further assess or take care of them, I think that your best bet is to get them to them as soon as possible. So obviously, I'm not sure that this, you know, them saying that they didn't think there was cardiac activity. Again, I don't know if it was on a subsequent image or not. But when we look at this video, I think, you know, we've got to support the cardiac function with as much fluids as we can. And if they're on anticoagulation, I'd probably reverse that. But other than that, I think until I can get them to a cardiothoracic surgeon and possibly even a confirmed diagnosis, I don't know that there's much else I can do. And when I say confirmed of what the underlying cause of this was, I'm curious what you would do in your practices. I know we all have different practices. I work at, like I said, a big referral hospital. If you're in a community practice or in a smaller hospital, I'd be curious to see what you would do. Please comment below with those things, because I think we can all learn from each other on this. I think that in this case, I'm not sure that the mortality's changed at all when they, you know, like it possibly misinterpreted this, or when they just didn't document this particular image. I hope you find that useful, and I hope you find these videos useful. If you have any suggestions or questions on videos or any content regarding clinical or ultrasound or point-of-care ultrasound, please let me know. You can reach me at pocusgeek@gmail.com. You can also follow me on Twitter @pocusgeek. If I find anything interesting for educational purposes, I do retweet those. And happy to have you around, and let me know what your thoughts are below.